Blessed be the God of our salvation, who bears our burdens and forgives our sins. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen.
Lord, have mercy upon us. Lord, have mercy upon us. Christ, have mercy upon us. Christ, have mercy upon us. Christ, have mercy upon us.
The Lord be with you.
And also
on this third Sunday in Lent, let us pray. Almighty God, you know that we have no power in ourselves to help ourselves. Keep us both outwardly in our bodies and inwardly in our souls, that we may be defended from all adversities which may happen to the body and from all evil thoughts which may assault and hurt the soul. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated for the reading of Holy Scripture.
A reading from the book of Exodus. Then God spoke all these words. I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself an idol, whether in the form of anything that is in heaven above, or that is on earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth. You shall not bow down to them or worship them. For I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, punishing children for the iniquity of parents, to the third and to the fourth generation of those who reject me, but showing steadfast love to the thousandth generation, to those who love me and keep my commandments. You shall not make wrongful use of the name of the Lord your God, for the Lord will not acquit anyone who misuses his name. Remember the Sabbath day and keep it holy. For 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is the Sabbath to the Lord your God. You shall not do any work, you, your son or your daughter, your male or female slave, your livestock, or the alien resident in your towns. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, the sea and all that is in them, but rested the seventh day. Therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and consecrated it. Honor your father and your mother, so that your days may be long in the land that your Lord your God is giving you. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife, or male or female slave, or ox or donkey, or anything but that belongs to your neighbor. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Let us read Psalm 19 in unison. The heavens declare the glory of God, and the firmament shows his handiwork. One day tells its tale to another, and one night imparts knowledge to another. Although they have no words or language, and their voices are not heard, their sound has gone out into all the lands, and their message to the ends of the world. In the deep has he set a pavilion for the sun. It comes forth like a bridegroom out of his chamber. It rejoices like a champion to run its course. It goes forth from the uttermost edge of the heavens and runs about to the end of it again. Nothing is hidden from its burning heat. The law of the Lord is perfect and revives the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure and gives wisdom to the innocent. The statutes of the Lord are just and rejoice the heart. The commandment of the Lord is clear and gives light to the eyes. The fear of the Lord is clean and endures forever. The judgments of the Lord are true and righteous altogether. More to be desired are they than gold, more than much fine gold, sweeter far than honey in the comb. By them also is your servant enlightened, and in keeping them there is great reward. Who can tell how often he offends? Cleanse me from my secret faults. Above all, keep your servant from presumptuous sins. Let them not get dominion over me. Then shall I be whole and sound and innocent of a great offense. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer.
A reading from the first letter of Paul to the Corinthians. The message about the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, and the discernment of the discerning I will thwart. Where is the one who is wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the debater of this age? Has not God made foolishness the wisdom of the world? For since in the wisdom of God, the world did not know God through wisdom, God has decided through the foolishness of our proclamation to save those who believe. For Jews demand signs, and Greeks desire wisdom. but we proclaim Christ crucified, a stumbling block to Jews and foolishness to Gentiles, but to those who are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ is the power of God and the wisdom of God. For God's foolishness is wiser than human wisdom, and God's weakness is stronger than human strength. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Holy Gospel of our Savior Jesus Christ, according to John. Glory to you, O Christ. The Passover of the Jews was near, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. In the temple, he found people selling cattle, sheep, and doves, and money changers at their tables. Making a whip of cords, he drove all of them out of the temple, both the sheep and the cattle. He also poured out the coins of the money changers and overturned their tables. He told those who were selling the doves, "Take these things out of here. Stop making my Father's house a marketplace." His disciples remembered that it was written, "Zeal for your house will consume me." The Jews then said to him, "What sign can you show us for doing this?" Jesus answered them, "Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up." The Jews then said, "This temple has been under construction for 46 years, and you will raise it up in 3 days?" But he was speaking of the temple of his body. After he was raised from the dead, his disciples remembered that he had said this, and they believed the scripture and the word that Jesus had spoken. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Jesus went up to Jerusalem. When we hear those words, it is a call to attention, because when Jesus goes up to Jerusalem, to the temple, something happens. Every time we hear about Jesus going to Jerusalem, something happens. We believe Jesus is God incarnate, God with skin on, coming to earth to show us how to live and to assure us of God's presence with us in the joys of life as well as in the sufferings of life. I confess I read today's gospel differently than I have in the past. And that is because of our current context as Episcopalians in North Central Texas. As Bishop Mayer mentioned last week, we preach from a revised common lectionary, meaning today's readings were selected years ago. When I first looked at the readings this week, I wondered what Jesus' anger in the temple had to say to us today, as many of us face losing our church buildings. I think I figured it out. Let's begin by retracing the times Jesus went to Jerusalem. As an infant, Jesus was dedicated in the temple by his parents, much like we baptize infants in our parishes today. Jesus' life was marked by worship in the temple, that place where people gather for worship and communion with other believers. With his family, Jesus went to Jerusalem every year for the festival of the Passover. It was a yearly discipline of preparation, much like our yearly Lenten discipline is preparation for Easter. You likely recall the story of the 12-year-old Jesus, about the age we go through confirmation classes. Jesus remaining in the temple after Passover had ended. His parents had begun the long journey back to Nazareth, and not seeing Jesus, decided he must have been with a different group of travelers, perhaps in a pod of gangly teenage boys avoiding hanging out with their parents. When they were at the end of the day's journey and still did not see Jesus, they returned to Jerusalem in search of him. After 3 days, they found him in the temple, sitting among the teachers, listening to them and asking them questions. All who heard Jesus were amazed at his understanding and insight. Even his parents were astonished. That, however, did not protect Jesus from a little motherly consternation that was a mixture of complete relief at finding him okay and anger that he did not tell her where he was going or what he was doing. You moms out there know exactly what I'm talking about. Scripture tells us Jesus went back to Nazareth with his family and continued making the Passover journey to Jerusalem each year. Early in his ministry, Jesus went to Jerusalem and something wonderful happened for a man who had not been able to walk for 38 years. There was a healing pool in Jerusalem where many blind, lame, and paralyzed people hung out. This particular man had no one to help him get into the healing pool. Jesus simply spoke to him, asking him if he wanted to be healed, and then said to him, "Stand up, take your mat and walk," which the man did. While this was a wonderful moment for the man who was healed, it was the beginning of the persecution Jesus would endure from the religious leaders of the day. They chastised Jesus because he healed on the Sabbath, on the day of rest. These leaders were unfazed by the restoration of health to this man who had been lame for so long. They didn't even seem curious about the power of compassion, healing, and restoration Jesus had. They were so caught up in applying the rules, they missed the very presence of the Messiah. In the lesson in John's Gospel today, we see Jesus again journeying to Jerusalem and stirring up a different kind of healing, a different kind of transformation. The Passover pilgrimage to Jerusalem was a holy experience for the faithful. They were to offer unto God the best of their livestock, clean and unblemished. Their worship included paying their temple tax, much like our giving of financial support to the church. Jesus was angry because the religious rulers turned this spiritual ritual into a competition. Whoever could afford to buy the best, purest, cleanest livestock would purportedly gain more benefit from their offering. It was not practical for the pilgrims to take their own livestock on the journey, as feeding them and keeping them clean was impossible. Thus, the business developed of having markets for the pilgrims to shop before arriving at the temple. At first, these markets were a reasonable distance away from the temple, but as the notion of great profit caught on, they set up shop right inside the temple courtyard. This led to corruption which was particularly nasty in its ties to religion. In addition to the marketplace, there were money changers. The Jewish people paid a temple tax each year and had to pay it with temple coins. Those traveling from great distances did not have the correct currency. They had to exchange their coins marked with Caesar or pagan inscriptions for those approved for temple use. Of course, the money changers charged a steep fee for this exchange. Jesus was angered by the price gouging committed against worshipers in this holy place, in the temple that held sacred memories for Jesus, his family, and generations of God's faithful people. These vendors were not participating in temple cleansing, but were defiling and contaminating these holy grounds. After throwing the vendors off the temple grounds, Jesus refers to the destruction of the temple and its rebuilding in 3 days. This perplexes his hearers until 3 days after the crucifixion, at the resurrection, when their hindsight reminds them of Jesus' words. Jesus was referring not to the temple building, but to himself as the temple of God. In the later chapters of the Gospel of John, Jesus warns against restricting worship to any physical site, for God is spirit and truth. Indeed, as the Gospel repeatedly states, the temple of Jesus' body is now where the spirit and truth of God are found. Jesus knew the importance of the temple as a place for faithful people to connect with each other, to share rites and rituals that were part of their tradition. Jesus grew up going to the temple and no doubt had formative and fond memories and connections to the building. Yet Jesus witnessed the dangers of people becoming overly connected to a building and missing out on God's glory right in front of them. Thus, when people worry about the fate of the temple, Jesus recenters our gaze. Rather than being consumed by a physical temple or church building, we are called to set our sights on Jesus, the incarnate God, who walks this wilderness path to Jerusalem with us. Because of this, we worship in spirit and truth wherever we may be. We see God's glory and hold fast to God's love made manifest in Christ, even when our plans are disrupted. We know when Jesus shows up in Jerusalem, in our Jerusalem, something happens, something for our good and for God's glory.
I invite you to stand as you're able and continuing in the words of the Creed. Let us say together. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is, seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father, who with the Father and the Son is worshiped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
God, we are in the wilderness. As much as we have tried to map, domesticate, and routinize every inch of your creation and every moment of our lives, We know that our maps do not tell us where we are with you, and that our schedules often serve to distract us from the reality that we ourselves and so many of our neighbors on this planet are in the wilderness too. And so we pray, here in this wilderness, prepare your way, O God. With all persons kept in poverty or slavery, all who are in fear from abusers, terrorists, and oppressors, all who face addiction of any kind, and all who are targeted for unjust treatment because of who they are, we pray, here in this wilderness, prepare your way, O God. With leaders in religious, political, economic, and social life, with our families, friends, and neighbors, and with all who work to sustain and protect our lives as military, civilian workers, and first responders, we pray, here in this wilderness, prepare your way, O God. With all who need your healing power, and with all who offer healing through their skill and presence, we pray, here in this wilderness, prepare your way, O God.
Receive the prayers of your people, most merciful God, and remain with us in these wilderness times. Grant us comfort and courage to restore relationships among God's people and God's created earth.
Amen.
Let us also pray for the forgiveness of our sins. Have mercy upon us, most merciful God. In your compassion, forgive us our sins, known and unknown, things done and left undone. And so uphold us by your Spirit, that we may live and serve you in newness of life, to the honor and glory of your name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Almighty God, have mercy upon you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in life everlasting. Amen. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The peace of Christ be always with you. The Spirit who drove Jesus into the wilderness, the Spirit drives us there as well. Settle in, make strange companions, endure the trials, trust the angels, learn the way. And the blessing of God Almighty, Creator, Redeemer, and Sanctifier, be upon you and remain with you in whatever wilderness you find yourself. Amen. Let us bless the Lord. Thanks be to God.